Okay, let's get started. The goal of this lecture is to explain the digital programmable euro. That's a topic which is quite hot now these days. And with this lecture, we would like to explain what is it exactly, what is the digital programmable euro, and why do we need it? My name is Philipp Sandner. I'm working at the Frankfurt School of Finance and Management. We have built a blockchain center there 4 years ago at the end of 2016, in the beginning of 2017. And we are now approximately 16 employees. Part of them are working part-time, and we're doing a lot of seminars, conferences in the past and in the future. We are doing a lot of studies and a lot of consulting projects. We are privately funded, as you can see here on the bottom. That's the companies which are currently funding our operations. That's, for example, Commerzbank as a bank, a law firm, MindFirst as another bank. Auditing company PwC, the custody company Metaco, and so on. So it's quite good blockchain companies also supporting us. So now let's talk about the digital programmable euro, especially what is it and why do we need it. So to directly jump into the topic, why do we need the digital programmable euro? So for example, if we are letting the euro run on a blockchain-based network. This will be explained in the second half of this lecture. In case we are doing this, in case the euro is listed on a blockchain network, for example, in form of a token, then of course, cross-border payments are much more easily being possible. So for example, a money transfer from here in Frankfurt to Argentina can take place within a couple of seconds, end to end, without a bank. So going from me to the target person in Argentina, the money transfer is being done within a couple of seconds. That's not possible by now. The next point is payment automation and business processes. For the technological people here, this is meant with the area called smart contracts. So what does it mean? Point one is that you would like to transfer money across the globe directly within a couple of seconds, but point two means that you might want to delay payments because there might be a business process which is forcing the payment to be delayed. Why would you do this? For example, in logistics, a good is traveling from China to Germany and the money needs to be paid, of course. The money is then traveling from Germany to China, and typically you would like to have it step by step. So once the good is basically being transported first half of the distance, then you would like to also get the money paid, the first half of the money. So it's step by step. That's an automated payment or an automated business process. This is what is meant by smart contracts, and it's much easier to automate payments and business processes with a blockchain euro or with the euro on top of a blockchain network. You can do all kinds of financial services with it, for example, leasing, factoring, loans, interest payments, escrow accounts, as I said, domains such as logistics, supply chain management, industry 4.0, and so on. All these areas would benefit from business processes where you can directly integrate payments, which are then executed on top of a blockchain-based network. The third thing is quite strongly related. It means that delivery and payment are strongly integrated. For example, in the area of securities trading, you nowadays have stocks, for example, the Daimler stock or the Apple stock, that's listed in one IT system, in one IT silo. You could also call this an exchange. And the money is being organized by another IT silo, that's the bank, for example, the money which is stored at the bank. So you have two silos which need to be reconciled once you are trading stocks. Because in case I am purchasing a Daimler stock or an Apple stock, for example, then I give money and I get the stock. So it's trading taking place. In the blockchain language, this would be an atomic swap. And right now it works as follows. I'm getting the share, yes, and I'm spending money, yes, but the finalizing the transaction such that it's really finalized and done takes typically 2 days in Europe. What I mean here is not the trading itself. In case you are purchasing a share, then right a second after you have purchased, you see that it's booked into your portfolio, but that's not enough. Until all systems in the background are running and all the entire transaction is really finalized, it still takes 2 days nowadays. In a blockchain world with the digital euro, you would have, for example, the stock listed on a DLT network as a security token. You would have money, that's the euro, on top of this blockchain network on the very same DLT network. So both tokens are on the same DLT network, the euro and the dime stock, for example, or other shares. And once you're now trading, then you're simply changing the ownership of these tokens on one and the same platform. So you don't need any intermediaries, you don't need two silos systems, but rather just one DLT system. And this allows you to basically do trading within a couple of seconds. And even more so, the transaction is really finalized. That it's about the finality of the transaction. The transaction is finalized after a couple of seconds, not as now 2 weeks. But delivery versus payment also meets all kinds of production processes and service processes. So for example, in case I'm consuming a digital good, or in case I'm consuming car sharing ride or whatever, then mobility is provided to me. Therefore, I have to pay. And right now, delivery is provided in one IT system, payment is provided in another IT system. This is called credit card, and it's not integrated. The processes are running quite smoothly, that's pretty sure, but still more efficiency can be gained. And the credit card payments, of course, are not for free. They are costing 0.5% to 2% of the transaction value. And therefore, integration of delivery versus payment can be done much more efficiently in real time without any transaction cost, in case you have the payment on a blockchain network and also the delivery, that's the product, that's the service, or that's the security. That's called DVP. And of course, as I said, this would be very, very nicely and efficiently done with the digital programmable euro. This is related to the fourth point, which means tokenization of rights and assets. This means that rights we already know from our world, and also assets which we are knowing in our world, such as stocks, for example, the Daimler stock, needs to somehow be deployed on a blockchain network. This is called tokenization, because the Daimler stock somehow needs to get into a token, such that the Daimler stock in form of a token can be denoted on a blockchain network, because only then it can be traded against euro on one and the same blockchain network. This is called tokenization, and this then also means it has a very important implication, because it's not just about putting the euro on a blockchain network, and this blockchain system would not just store cash, you know, like the euro. It only makes sense, in my personal opinion, if you have a DLT network where there is the euro on top of it and all kinds of other rights and assets. So there is the euro on this system, there is the Daimler stock on this system, all kinds of other shares, the Apple stock, and all kinds of other assets. There are also other products, for example, insurance solutions. All these things are running on one and the same DLT network next to each other, such that you can trade with them, such that you can purchase things on one and the same network. And therefore, of course, you have to first tokenize all kinds of rights and assets, because only then you have these multiple tokens on one and the same DLT system. And the fifth point here means the realm of the machine economy, the Internet of Things. This means that at some point of time, things will be paying. That can be easily explained, for example, with autonomous driving. So imagine the taxi as we know it now. The taxi in the future will also be a taxi, but without a taxi driver. Yeah, so that's basically autonomous driving. That's taxi without a taxi driver. That's a thing, a device which is moving around. Now imagine you're driving to holiday. Let's take northern Italy. You're driving from Germany to Italy. Then you're passing the Brenner. That's a mountain route. And there's a toll station, and you have to pay €8.50 such that you are allowed to pass this street. Right now, I'm as a human being sitting in the car, I'm handing over €8.50 to the person in the toll station. So it's basically person to person transfer of money. And therefore, I have the grant, the access for the route such that I can drive to holiday in northern Italy, right? In the machine economy with autonomous driving in the future, you would also drive to Italy, but then you would have a device, an autonomous device driving you. That's the autonomous car. And the toll station would also be autonomous. So it's basically a machine-to-machine transfer of money which is happening, because the car driving me, it will be sending money to the toll station where there is not a human being sitting anymore, because it's an automated toll station. So it's a money transfer which is organized between machines. And we will have tons of such machine-to-machine payments which are coming up. This is primarily important for the German and the European industry because especially the German industry relies a lot on machinery, sensors, automotive equipment, healthcare technology or medical technology. All these are devices or machines and they will be connected to the internet. In fact, they are partly already connected to the internet, but a share of these machines will also engage in payment transfers, as I have explained with this example. We see this multiply, it's happening in the future. And for this, we need to have an infrastructure such that machines can be connected to the euro payments. This would be DLT. And you also need an infrastructure to connect not just a couple of machines, but millions, maybe tens or hundreds of millions of machines being connected to a payment infrastructure. This can be best handled by a blockchain or a DLT network. Right now, we're having the year 2020, and estimations are telling us that by 2025, that's 5 years from now, we will have approximately 20 billion devices connected to the internet on the world. 20 billion devices, that is 3 times more devices in comparison to human beings on the planet, right? That's really an enormous number, and this number will strongly increase in the next 5 years. And of course, these devices to some degree not just will be connected to the internet, a share of them will also be transacting in payment. Yeah, and therefore, given these numbers, which I just have explained, you can easily see it will be a huge business, the machine economy. It will be hundreds of millions of devices, and these devices, they need a payment infrastructure. They would do accounting in euro, not in IOTA and not in Bitcoin. They would like to do accounting in euro or in US dollar. Why is this? Because they need this for accounting procedures. And of course, they not just do payment by sending money around, but they will be parts of business processes. That's the point two here, such that conditional payments are happening, such that devices can directly operate in the area of leasing, factoring, escrow accounts, and so on. Yeah. So that's the key 5 points from an industrial perspective why the digital program of the euro does make sense. And of course, you can say that the euro system and the payment systems as they are working now, they are already good at doing specific things. You know, of course, some people would say that cross-border payments are already working quite efficiently, but still with blockchain technology, you get it done in real time at close to zero transaction cost. Plus, even more so, that's very important, with blockchain technology, you get all these 5 benefits in combination, so you don't have to compromise on specific aspects here. Blockchain technology allows you to have all these 5 benefits jointly being achieved. And the 6th is, of course, that's a more generic thing, which is true, especially for blockchain technology. It's IT security and system resilience, which is definitely there for DLT system. So what kind of digital euros types are out there? So first of all, there is the term programmable money, which is now getting more and more attention in public authorities, in the public administration, but also in companies. For example, the Federal Ministry of Finance is dealing with the topic. The central banks around the world are examining this topic. The European Commission is doing it. The German Association of Banks in Berlin is doing it. So you have like tons of association companies exploring it. And very often it's a little bit chaotic because people are very often really clearly defining what they are talking about. And therefore, let's quickly distinguish a couple of different types of programmable money. So on the left-hand side, you have CBDCs, that's a well-known term. It means that the European Central Bank would issue the euro. And here you have a couple of other types. For example, you have a retail CBDC. This means that you have an end user who is basically a human being or a company or a public authority, and they would like to use the euro. And in this type, the retail CBDCs, there are multiple models. The direct model, where human beings are directly connected to the central bank, that's quite unrealistic, to be honest. Then there is the hybrid model, where you have the existing system of the central bank and the commercial banks, which are working hand in hand to serve payment infrastructure to human beings and machines. And there is the indirect model. And most probably, we will see on the long run a system, something like the hybrid model or the indirect model, being realized. The Chinese, they are already working on a CBDC project since quite a while, and they also have found the hybrid model, as far as I know, to be the most the most one which is fitting in the best case. And on the right hand side, you would have private organizations issuing money. And here you have regulated entities, that's for example commercial banks, e-money institutes, and so on, who are issuing money. That's the middle box on the lower half. That's basically the standard for us as human beings. In case I'm doing online banking, then I'm not interacting with the central bank, then I'm interacting with my bank, with a commercial bank, which is providing an online banking app to me. And that's why that's basically the default here in the middle, such that a commercial bank, as they are out there already now, will issue the euro in a similar way as, for example, PayPal is issuing their money payment operations, or as a bank is operating their online banking app. And on the right-hand side, it's also possible that private organizations issuing money, but these private organizations, they might not be regulated. So it might also be unregulated organizations issuing money. This is, for example, then mostly approaches from the crypto asset world. For example, you have the MakerDAO Foundation, which is issuing the DAI, that's a private stablecoin backed by crypto assets. Then you also have private stablecoins backed by existing currencies as a collateral. That's the Project Tether, Stasis, True US Dollar, and so on. That's the most important stablecoins out there. But of course, their capitalizations is only at 4, 5, 6 billion US dollar. It sounds much, but in comparison to other capitalizations of money, that's not too much. But still, it's significant and growing. And then also you have private stablecoins backed by a currency basket. That is what we have learned to be the Libra solution as we know it from last year. Libra has morphed into a new system such that Libra is not just a basket currency, but rather a payment infrastructure, which is also allowing the euro, the Swiss franc, and the US dollar and so on to be denoted on this Libra platform. This has been published in April this year. And therefore, we can now also say that Libra 2.0 seeks to be a currency issued by a regulated entity. That's the middle box, right? Similarly, like the JPM coin and so on. So as I said, on the long run, it's most probable that we have the European Central Bank and other central banks issuing money in the hybrid model or the indirect model. Most probably, China is also doing this. So China, for example, has started with this in 2014, that's 6 years ago. And they are now testing the system with first people receiving their salary on their network, which they call the DCEP network. DCEP means Digital Currency Electronic Payments Network. So they started 6 years ago, and they are now in the position that they now can test their system with first real payments going out to people receiving their salary on their network, denoted in their Chinese currency. The ECB, or employees of the ECB, are saying that China with this is at least 5 years ahead. Realistically, because in Europe we are doing this at a much slower pace, to be honest, realistically China is therefore more or less 6 to 8 years ahead with the current intensity that Europe is tackling this. That's a little bit sad, but that's the fact. So a CBDC for the euro, it would be issued in forms of the ECB issuing money probably by 2026 or 2028. That's quite a while downstream, right? China will issue their currency and launch their DCBE system by 2020, maybe this year or maybe next year. Yeah, so you see here, China is really moving ahead. The European authorities are much slower. That's not necessarily bad, because we can also have solutions in Europe where private organizations are issuing money. The same is happening now. For example, in case I pay my rent for my apartment, in case I'm doing online banking, PayPal, that's all private money. That's not a CBDC. So in case companies would act, then we would have the digital euro on a much shorter term. And this would also then make the ECB with their potential CBDC ambitions, which are coming to us maybe just in a couple of years by 2026 or 2028, not too bad, because we will have an intermediate solution by commercial banks which are issuing the euro. Why does it make sense for Europe? Because in Europe, innovation typically happens in the private sector. So in Europe, we need more initiatives coming from the private sector, from commercial banks, to provide the digital euro by a couple of years before 2028. So the private sector could launch specific solutions already next year. And in the next slides, I would like to quickly outline how this could work, because then it's okay that the CBDC is issued by the European Central Bank in a couple of years, because as demand for such a solution is picking up by the industry, we will already have solutions out there, which is also coming from the private sector, such that all the future business models of companies from Bosch, Daimler, and so on, such that they have a digital programmable euro to operate with, even though it's just money issued from a private organization and not a CBDC. But that's not too bad, actually, even if it sounds so, because all money which we are using privately these days, online banking, PayPal, and so on, that's all money privately issued by regulated entities. So this is, in my mind, a very good way forward. That's exactly why we, a couple of weeks ago in June 2020, have developed a very small roadmap map towards a digital programmable euro. It has been received more than 100 signees within 2 days. On the lower hand, you see the QR code such that you can access it. And here you are working here in an area where it's quite dynamic. The roadmap is being developed, and we are proposing for, this roadmap as it's listing here. So, for example, we should use this year, 2020, for building knowledge, exchanging views, because very often senior decision makers don't have the time to really inspect blockchain technology in a very deep way. So they need more time to really understand the technology, or they need time to employ people who are then really the specialists on this field. So we need just a little bit more time to build knowledge, especially on the senior decision making levels in hierarchies of companies and also public administrations. Then by Q2 2021, it would be possible to have an DLT enabling payment API. To explain this quickly, what we mean here is that it's basically the euro as we know it sitting on IBAN accounts with banks, but we create a DLT system, or we leverage DLT systems out there, and we are combining the DLT system with the payment API of banks. With this, you would not have the euro on top of a blockchain network. You also would not have the euro in form of a token on a blockchain network, but you would have a DLT network with all its benefits, which are out there, directly connected to payment. And with this, you would have the same solution. That is, for example, Daimler, Bosch, and all these companies, they could do blockchain created payment in euro, even though the euro is not leaving the bank accounts, for example, the IBAN accounts, right? So you're simply connecting DLT infrastructure to payment APIs, but you have to twist the IT a little bit, because you have to make euro payments, euro transmission such that they cannot be reversed. Because if you would allow payments in euro to be reversed, then the payment system, that's basically the IBAN accounts and the DLT networks, they would then go out of sync. So you need to create the system such that the DLT network and the money on the banks is always perfectly in sync. Then that's enough for 2021, when Daimler, Siemens, Bosch, and all these companies are starting to develop their future business models in the area of logistics, supply chain management, industry 4.0, possibly data monetization, and so on. That's okay. But as soon as payments are then getting smaller, micropayments are needed, more automation is needed, and so on, then we need to have another solution, such that this bridge solution, the DLT enabling payment API, is not enough. Therefore, we would propose and recommend that by Q4 2022, the establishment of a euro token standard should be done, such that the euro can be issued on various DLT networks. So we need to standardize the token such that the euro can be basically plugged into a token, such that the euro then in form of a token can be run on multiple DLT networks. It would work already now such that the euro is running on multiple DLT networks, but since it's not standardized, you cannot compare the one euro to another euro. Why is this? Because you might have a huge counterparty risk here and another transaction fee there. So you cannot really compare these different setups of the euro. Therefore, we need to have a standardized euro, because only then we are getting interoperability between the euro across different networks. And then, for example, by Q1 2024, the European Central Bank could issue their CBDC, for example. This could then be the long-term solution, probably also the best solution, but we cannot wait until 2025, 2026, until this happens. We need to have intermediate solutions. We need to have bridge solutions up until this point of time. That's why we proposed the Euro token standard by 2022 and also the DLT enabling API by 2021. And why do we need this? That's now the key rationale there. Right now, the classical economy runs as follows. You have industrial domains, for example, mobility, machinery, sensors, logistics, and energy. And you have classical financial domains, for example, payment, leasing, securitization, factoring, and so on. On the left-hand side, you have traditional manufacturing companies. On the right-hand side, you have financial organizations. And very often, these companies, they are operating in silos. So here's an example. You have this truck. This truck would like to travel somewhere. It's transporting goods. And because it's transporting goods, it's, of course, charging a fee for transporting these goods. It's an autonomous vehicle, and it automatically pays for maintenance and electricity. It all automatically receives money from the transported goods, and then this truck moves around Europe, for example. Yeah. So it's an automated business model. It's a small automated business model which collects money from those goods which are being transported, and it sends money for those people to those organizations supplying it with energy or maintenance, for example. It's an automated business model. So here you see that mobility meets payment. Yeah. So you have an industrial domain, that's the truck, meeting finance domain, that's pay per use on the right hand side. Another example is this one. You have this sensor. This sensor is just an example. The sensor would automatically collect data and could be humidity values, temperature values, or any kind of other data. And once this data is being stored in the cloud by the sensor, it's then available for being purchased. So for example, I could go to the sensor and ask the sensor, please send me the data from yesterday. And then the sensor would say, okay, you can get the data, but you have to first pay me €1.50. Then I would pay €1.50 via blockchain to the sensor. That's a thing. This thing needs to receive the money. And once the sensor can confirm the incoming money, then he would reveal the data to me. In another way, for example, some kind of organization could go to the sensor and tell it, please send me the entire data of last year. And then the sensor would say, okay, I can do this. It costs €150. Please send me the money. Then I send you the data. That's basically sensor technology now combined with an escrow mechanism, because the sensor would only send the data once the money has been paid and vice versa. And that's exactly what I personally believe, is that we will see ecosystems emerging exactly at the intersection between industrial domains from the left-hand side and financial domains on the right-hand side. That's exactly blockchain in my mind at its best. There you have companies, business models, startups operating directly at the intersection between the left-hand silos and the right-hand silos. That's exactly where integration happens. And in my mind, these are brilliant business models which will require blockchain as an infrastructural technology. Yeah, with this, I would like to close. In case you would like to have further questions, please contact me, and you can contact me with email, LinkedIn, Twitter, or whatever means you would like to have in mind. And we then continue with the second half of this lecture, which is then now explaining why blockchain technology is a good technology to basically provide the digital program of the euro. Here's our book. In case you're interested in this, you're welcome to, of course, purchase this. It's a good one. It's actually two books, one focusing on blockchain and society, written in Germany, and one company on the right-hand side focusing on blockchain companies and the financial sector. It's written not just by one or two authors, it's written by in total 30 or 32 authors. That's basically people from really good companies, experts in the DLT domain in Germany, Switzerland, and so on. People from Börse Stuttgart, people from Daimler, they all have compiled all what they know in this in these two books. So in case you're interested further in this topic, then you're welcome, of course, to read it.